Aspinwall Church. It is indeed an honor for me to be able to share a few words of encouragement with the people of Aspinwall tonight. I appreciate the opportunity, the invitation that was extended to me to share the word tonight. Appreciate so very much Pastor John and Sister Angie and the whole Walden family and what your friendship to me, Pastor John, means. I can't quite put into words. I am so ready for this coronavirus pandemic to be past us. I am anxiously anticipating the time when I can invite Pastor John and Sister Angie down to my house for a cookout. I hope that it won't be too long before we get the chance to fellowship like that again. Well, I want to offer my congratulations to Leah and Jalen for their high school graduation, and certainly want to offer my congratulations as well to Sister Angie and the completion of her master's degree. I'm so proud of all three of you. Just love you all, and so glad that you've given me this invitation to share the word with you today. I have enjoyed listening each night to the guest speakers that have been a part of this revival of sorts, and it's just been wonderful. And I would tell you that Pastor John saved the best for last, but he saved me for last, so it is what it is. But I am glad to be here tonight. I want to read a passage of Scripture in the book of Revelation. And so if you want to read along with me, I'll be reading from the second chapter of the book of Revelation, beginning with verse number 1. Unto the angel of the church at Ephesus write, these things saith he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. I know thy works, and thy labor, and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear them which are evil, and thou hast tried them which say they are apostles and are not, and hast found them liars, and hast borne and hast patience, and for my name's sake hast labored and hast not fainted. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. Remember, therefore, from whence thou art fallen, and repent and do the first works, or else I will come unto thee quickly and will remove thy candlestick out of his place, except thou repent. But this thou hast, that thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitanes, which I also hate. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. I want to direct your attention tonight to verses 4 and 5. Jesus, speaking to the church at Ephesus, said, nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. Remember, therefore, from whence thou art fallen, and repent, and do the first works. I want to begin tonight by sharing a story with you. A man and his wife were at dinner celebrating their 10th wedding anniversary. The three children were at home with the babysitter, and it was refreshing for the two of them to spend one evening alone. Sitting in silence, enjoying their supper, the wife noticed several couples around her. A married young couple sat talking while they waited for their food. Two teenagers were talking so closely together on the same side of their booth that their noses nearly touched. Another young couple sat holding hands across the table, just looking at each other. After gazing around the room, the woman looked across the table at her husband, who was so busy eating that he hadn't noticed her staring at him. When she cleared her throat, he finally looked up and discovered her stare. "What?" he asked after her silent gaze seemed to last forever. "Do you think we have a problem with our marriage?" she asked. "Where did that question come from?" the man returned, puzzled by what could have prompted such an interrogation on their wedding anniversary. "Do you still love me?" she asked. "I'm still here," he answered. "That's a pretty good sign when the divorce statistics say we've well outlasted the normal marriage. Why would you ask such a question?" Well, I've been looking around at some of the other couples in here, she said. They're all talking, and we're just sitting here in silence. What did you want to talk about? The husband asked. Well, nothing in particular, the wife continued. I just wondered if we should be talking. The husband just stared at his wife blankly, still not having any idea where this conversation was heading. Remember when we were dating, she asked? You used to sit on the same side of the booth with me. Do you want me to move? No, that's not it. She said, remember how you used to buy me flowers? You want flowers? What kind do you want? You want roses? No, I don't want flowers. The husband interrupted, you're confusing me. She said, I've just noticed a few things are different than they used to be. Like when we were dating, we saw each other almost every day. And when we didn't see each other, we talked on the phone. We talked on the phone every day, sometimes for hours. So you want me to call you? The husband asked. The wife just ignored his last question as she continued, do you think I'm pretty? Honey, you know I think you're gorgeous. I tell you, you're beautiful all the time. But you don't look at me the way you used to, she said. You mean like this? He raised his eyebrow and bit his lower lip. He said, sure I do. No, that's not it. I mean the gleam in your eye, the smile from your soul is gone. What are you trying to say? The husband asked. She finally responded, darling, I know you love me. You work hard to earn a decent living. You put food on the table. Our bills are paid. You give me all the things I need and almost everything I ask for. I know you've been faithful to me. I know I can always trust you. I know you'd do anything to make me happy. I know you love me. I just wonder if you love me like you did in the beginning. That's at the heart of the text that I read to you today. In the text, Christ's beef with the church is that they had left their first love. It's important to understand what that means. See, the church at Ephesus had not forsaken Christ. That phrase, your first love, it's not referring to Jesus, the person, as a first love. They hadn't backslid. Jesus said, I know you're working. I see your hard work, and I know you've been at it a while, and you still aren't slowing down. I know you can't stand evil. You can spot a phony a mile away and always put them in their place. You've suffered and suffered patiently, and yet you're still holding on. That's not a backslidden church. Jesus said, my problem with you is that you have left your first love. That is, the love that you had at the first. It wasn't who they loved that had changed. It was how they loved that had changed. Your first love that you had at the beginning. I was thinking about the way that social distancing and our response to the current pandemic has affected the way that we're able to worship. It's affected the way we're able to worship publicly and corporately. It's affected our church attendance and the ability to gather together. These last couple of months have been altogether different for those of us who have grown up with the church at the forefront of our lives, all of our lives. And I was thinking about how in that in the confinement in our homes, and with the absence of church, sometimes we're put in a position to where if we're not careful, we will discover that our attitudes about the Lord have changed somewhat. Our passion, that fire that we have for the Lord, is not the same as it used to be. And it could be today that if we would examine our own lives and examine our own hearts, check ourselves, we may discover that we too do not love Jesus the way that we once loved Jesus. Or that love that we used to have is not the same love that we currently have. You've left your first love, the love that you had at the beginning. Jesus' words for the church at Ephesus were to remember this from when thou art fallen and repent and do the first works. To remember, to repent, and to redo. Amen. Say that with me. To remember, to repent, and to redo. Remember the first love. Remember from whence thou art fallen. Remember how things used to be. When I think about the church at Ephesus, And I think about their love. I think about their first love. The Bible gives us an adequate description of the church at Ephesus. And it gives us an adequate description of the way that they loved at the beginning. Now, we know from our reading in the book of Acts and Paul's establishment of the church at Ephesus. We also know from Paul's letter to the Ephesians. And then what Jesus says about them in Revelation chapter number 2. We know a lot of things about the church at Ephesus and the way that they loved at the beginning. Notice their love for Christ had changed. They had not left their deeds. They had not left the intensity of their work. They had not become weary in their well-doing. They were still doing just as much when John was banished to the Isle of Patmos that they'd ever been doing. They were still very busy for Christ. They had not compromised their conviction. The problem then must have been in their motivation. I want to ask you today to carefully consider what we're doing and why we're doing it. Consider the love of Christ for a motivation. I was thinking today about the way that we worship in the beginning, our love for Christ at the first. And I want to ask you to stop and to remember. That's what Jesus said. Remember from whence thou art fallen. I want you to remember what it was like when you first got saved. Remember how you loved Jesus when you first got saved. Remember how that prayer was a part of your everyday life. Prayer was pivotal. It was not something that you did when you ran out of other things to do. It wasn't something that you did after you'd done everything else that you needed to do. But prayer was a priority. You remember when you first fell in love with Jesus and you found it easy to find things to be thankful for, and you were grateful for things that now, very frankly, you take for granted. You remember that love that you had in the beginning, where there was a song that was always on your heart, where feeling the presence of God was not something that took place only occasionally, but constantly you desired to know His nearness. When you went to church every time to get a blessing, and every time you went to church, you got a blessing. I'm talking about that passion for Christ that consumed us at the very beginning. Remember that. The church at Ephesus was marked for their love for Christ, and they were marked by their love for the Word. When Paul stopped at Ephesus very briefly on his second missionary journey, those in the synagogue begged Paul to stay longer. Apollos followed Paul to Ephesus, and the people there responded to his mighty knowledge of the Scripture. When Paul returned on his third missionary journey, he spent 2 or 3 years there in Ephesus, teaching in the synagogue and in their homes and in the school of Tyrannus. In Acts chapter 19, verse number 10, it says, "And this continued by the space of 2 years, so that all they which dwelt in Asia heard the word of the Lord Jesus, both Jews and Greeks." And verse number 20 of Acts 19 says, "And so mightily grew the word of God and prevailed." The church at Ephesus, in the beginning, their first love, their first passion was a love for the Word of God. They had zero tolerance for bad doctrine. And they still did. And according to what Jesus said in Revelation chapter 2 in our text, they knew the Word of God so well that they could spot a phony. But was it His Word that they defended so well? Or was it their own viewpoint? Was it a love for the Word? Or was it a love for their own narrow-mindedness? I want to ask you, do you remember how it was when you first got saved? I'm asking you to remember your first love, when you fell in love with the Word of God, and discipleship was a priority, when you couldn't miss a church service because you expected God to do something significant in your life every single church service, when you found yourself undistracted by anything while the preacher was preaching, because you were so intent on hearing what the Word of God had to say, as if Jesus was speaking to you, dictating the Word of God to you himself. You sincerely prayed every altar service to draw closer to God, to be filled with the Spirit, and to be more like Him. When you read your Bible every day, because every day the Word of God was speaking to you at the place where you were, speaking into your specific set of circumstances. When you participated in Sunday school class, and when you listened intently to every sermon that was preached, knowing that God was speaking for you. The church at Ephesus was marked by their love for the Word. And the church at Ephesus was marked for their love for the lost. I'm talking about your first love. The church at Ephesus, they loved the lost. There were many that were converted in Ephesus. When you read Luke's account of of Paul's visit to Ephesus in the 19th chapter of the book of Acts, you discover that so many were being saved that it changed the culture of the city. They burned their books of witchcraft and sorcery. So many were saved that secular businesses and industry were put out of business. And I was thinking how that it seems like today the church seems to have got the cart in front of the horse. And so many churches, it seems like they've made it their mission to put ungodly businesses out of business. When in reality, our priority, our passion ought to be to see lost people saved. And when people get saved, then inappropriate businesses, then wicked businesses will go out of business. They'll fold up because revival has captivated their hearts. Remember that love that you had at the beginning. Remember your first love. How that when you first got saved, when you first experienced that life-changing power of Christ, that the burden of sin was lifted up off of you and you became a new creature in Christ, you felt like everybody should feel like you do. You wanted everybody to experience what you were experiencing. Remember when sharing your testimony and witnessing for Christ came natural and without effort, because you were so full of the new life that Christ had given you that you wanted everybody to know what Jesus had done in you. When seeing someone you care for waste their life, ruin their marriage, or harming their body, when it touched your heart and it pricked you and caused you to want to take action so that they can see what you see, you wanted them to experience what you have experienced. When the thought of someone that you love dying without Christ and going to hell, it so horrified you that you could not keep your peace. I'm talking about a love for the lost. And the church at Ephesus had that love. I've got somewhat against you, Jesus said, because you've left your first love. That church at Ephesus, they had a love for the ministry. They had a love for those that spread the gospel of Jesus Christ, for servants of the Most High. What can we say about the way that the Ephesians treated Priscilla and Aquila while they were there? Or what can we say of their reception to the Apostle Apollos, or their training of Tychicus and Trophimus there at Ephesus? The Bible tells us in Acts chapter number 20 that Paul had determined to sell by Ephesus when he was on his way back to Jerusalem. And you're familiar, I know, with the context when Paul was going to Jerusalem, knowing that harm there awaited him. And as a matter of fact, it had been prophesied to him again and again that he would be bound there in Jerusalem. But Paul had determined to sell by Ephesus because he would not spend time in Asia. For he hasted, if it were possible, to be at Jerusalem the day of Pentecost. And from Miletus he sent to Ephesus and called for the elders of the church. The Bible goes on to say that they met him there, and that he shared his heart with the elders at Ephesus. And when he had thus spoken, he kneeled down and prayed with them all. And they all wept sore and fell on Paul's neck and kissed him, sorrowing most of all for the words which he spake, that they should see his face no more. And they accompanied him into the ship. That passion that the Ephesians had for the Apostle Paul. They loved the man of God. They loved the messenger of God. I want to ask you, do you remember the love that you had for Pastor John and Sister Angie when he first became your pastor? That's that same passion that I believe the Lord is trying to cause us to remember. I know that you still love Pastor John, or you wouldn't go to church. I know you still love his preaching, but I'm asking you to remember the way you loved it at the beginning. I thought about the church at Ephesus was filled with people that longed to demonstrate their feelings and their heart for the man of God. Paul would write his last letter to Timothy, and he told Timothy, he said, "I want the Lord to give mercy unto the house of Onesiphorus, for he oft refreshed me and was not ashamed of my chain. But when he was in Rome, he sought me out very diligently and found me. The Lord grant unto him that he may find mercy of the Lord in that day, and in how many things he ministered unto me at Ephesus, thou knowest very well." So Paul was telling Timothy, he said, "You remember Onesiphorus and the way that he refreshed me and the way that he ministered to me." Amen. It's that kind of passion from the church at Ephesus, that first love for the ministry that I want us to remember tonight and to come back to. There was a time in your life when you loved the ministry, when the servants of God were precious to you, and when serving the church and serving the Lord was an utmost priority in your life. Remember when you prayed earnestly for the Lord to use you. We sang songs like, "Jesus, use me. Dear Lord, don't refuse me. Surely there's a work that I can do." When serving God in ministry gave you a purpose in your life and filled your life with meaning, and you sought for ways to be a blessing to the church and to relieve a burden for the pastor. Let me do whatever I can. I'm talking about a love for ministry, and the church at Ephesus was marked by love for ministry. The church at Ephesus was marked for their love for other Christians, for their love for other believers. Paul wrote his letter to the Ephesians, and he said in the first chapter, verse 15, "Wherefore I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and love unto all the saints." That was one of the two things that I first heard about the church at Ephesus. I heard that they had faith in Jesus, they trusted Christ, and I heard that they loved one another. He wrote in the fourth chapter of his epistle to the Ephesians, "I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that ye walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you're called, with all lowliness and meekness, with long suffering, forbearing one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace." And so Paul, writing to the church at Ephesus, and said, "Hey, you remember how in the very beginning you were filled with lowliness and you were filled with meekness and you had learned to forbear one another. You had a lot of patience one for another." Paul said, "I am writing to you that you would strive to keep that same unity, that same spirit in your hearts. Keep that growing and let it grow stronger and stronger." He tells them to speak the truth in love, that you may grow up in him in all things, which is the head, even Christ. And he said in Ephesians 5:2, "To walk in love, as Christ also hath loved us and hath given himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savor." So they were marked for their passion, for their love for Jesus Christ. You remember that love that you had at the beginning when fellowship with the saints was a pleasure. When being with other Christians made you happy. I hope that this pandemic has driven you crazy because it has limited your ability to be with the people of God. You remember how it was in the beginning when you got to church early and you was the last one to leave because you wanted to be able to spend time to visit with your brothers and sisters in Christ. You felt significant, like you were a part of something greater than yourself because you were a part of the family of God. Remember, Paul said, and repent, or Jesus said to the church in Ephesus, remember and repent and redo. Remember that love that you had at the beginning. Remember that passion. I hope that tonight, as I have talked about that first love, the way that you loved in the beginning, I hope that your heart has been stirred and you've thought about ways in which your passion for Christ and the things of Christ is not like it was when your relationship with Him was brand new. And I want to call you today to repentance. I want to call you today to think differently about where you're at. You know, we get so lazy. We just take things the way they are, and we just accept things. Well, that's just the way that it is. And I want you to consider repenting today, to change the way you think about it, and to pray about it, to turn around and say, by God's help, by God's grace, I'm going to fix this. I'm going to go back and I'm going to redo. Do those first works, Jesus said. Go back and start all over again. Go back and do the first works, to pray and to read God's word and to light that fire of passion that you had in the very beginning. I want to encourage you today to allow God to rekindle that same fire that you felt. And let's pray that way. Lord, save me all over again tonight. Lord, restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. Lord, bring me back to the way that I felt the first time that I got up out of an altar. Lord, fill me with that and fuel me with that passion to do more for Christ and to do more for the church and for the kingdom of God. I want to encourage you today to let God restore that first love in your heart again. What a blessing it has been tonight to be able to share this word with you. I appreciate everything that the Aspenwall Church does on a regular basis, what the impact that you're making in the community that God has called you to, and the service that you are to so many people. I want to encourage you to keep that up, but I also want to encourage you to check your motives. And to don't just be so busy doing the same things you've been doing, but to go back and remember the motive behind it all was what Jesus said, inasmuch as you did it unto one of the least of these, you did it unto me. We're serving the Lord Jesus Christ. Let that passion for Christ consume everything that you do. What a joy it has been to share with you the word tonight. I'm looking forward to the next opportunity that I'll have to come to Cleveland and to be with you in person. Until that time, I'm praying for the church there. I'm praying for the leadership there and praying that God would add souls to the kingdom through the work and the ministry of the Aspenwall Church. God bless you tonight. Don't forget services tomorrow. Let's worship the Lord together and let's recommit to doing what we can for the body of Christ. Pastor John, Sister Angie, we love you. We love the Aspenwall Church family. God bless you all, and good night until we see each other again.